All right, so thanks all for taking your time to help us push this conversation, this incredibly important conversation, about our future. And I know you started this morning by thinking about our past. And for me, it's important that we contextualize this journey that we're on. We're today on the banks of the Elbow River. We're in this place where people have been gathering for thousands of years. Coming to this spot, Mokinstis, the Elbow, the place where two rivers meet. Coming here to hunt and fish and trade, to live, to love, to fight sometimes, but above all, to build community. And that's what we continue to do today. I'm going to talk a little bit about social resilience as we move forward, but I think that it's particularly helpful for us to think about that concept in a world that sometimes feels a little uncertain, in a world that feels a little scary, in a world where it feels like the lights are going out one after the other, a world where it feels like voices of intolerance and hatred are growing louder and louder, a world where it feels like the voices that would tear us apart are prevailing over those that would bring us together. And it's important for us to remember that we come from that long history of community building. That the original inhabitants of this land, the Nitsitepi, the people, we call them the Blackfoot people now, have always generously shared this land with others. Whether the Beaver people, the Sutina people who came from the north, or the Stoney people, the Nakota people who came from the east, or the Métis people with whom we walk hand in hand, or for the last 150 years or so, people from every corner of this broken earth coming here to this place of welcome, of safety, of sanctuary, and above all, of opportunity. And when we talk about the true resilience of this place and of making this place even more resilient, we're talking about building on that history. That history of a place of welcome, of safety, of sanctuary, of opportunity. And that's the job, the challenge that we all face today in building an even more resilient Calgary. So, that's my very long way of saying thank you for coming. Because the conversations that we're having are incredibly important. They're not about buzzwords. They're not about joining this cool network. They are, in fact, fundamental questions about who we want to be, who we are, and who we want to be. Special thanks to my colleagues at the City of Calgary who probably thought this workshop was never ever going to come. They've been working on this for a long time. Thanks to our guests from 100 Resilient Cities, Otis and Katya, and all of the others who've been helping with this journey as well. We're very excited to be part of the 100 Resilient Cities network. It's an important thing because it's allowing us to figure out who we are and where we want to go. We are a resilient community, we know that. We know that we are able to withstand and build back from stresses and shocks, and we've experienced different kinds of stresses and shocks time and time and time and time again through our history. Our downtown is made of sandstone because the wood buildings burnt down. And this is still continuing to this day, us thinking about these stresses and shocks. They can be chronic complex issues, like poverty, economic swings, unemployment, lack of housing, wellness. Wellness doesn't really fit on that list. Lack of wellness, how's that? And then there's shocks like severe weather, fire, disease outbreaks, extreme temperatures. And we're well known for how we respond to these things. We remain connected to each other, supportive to each other. We work hard together to manage through these disruptions to our daily lives. And that's part of resiliency. You know, when we think, of course, about the 2013 flood, I never thought that I would, after the flood, have to say, then the costliest natural disaster in Canadian history. Who knew that only 3 years later there'd be a more costly natural disaster, the wildfires in Fort McMurray, but then the costliest natural disaster in Canadian history. And we think about how we made it through that. We think about what we do on the third Saturday in June every year, celebrate Neighbor Day. celebrate our linkages together as a community, to think about how we came together that flood, how we came together through that event. But what we need to do, in addition to having outstanding response to these sorts of shocks, is also think about how we withstand our community against those shocks. To continue the example of the flood, talking about mitigation and flood resilience is as important as talking about response. And that's really one of the reasons why we're coming together in all of this today. Being part of the 100 Resilient Cities Network is certainly about that, a network for inspiration, for support, for resources. We have access to those other cities that are on the resilience journey. We can share best practices, we can learn from them, they can learn from us. But we also have the ability to build our own unique, made-in-Calgary approaches to share everywhere else. We live in a unique time in history. For the first time in human history, the majority of people on this earth live in cities. We're an urban globe. And that urbanization trend is only going to continue. Which of course means we need to think about cities in a smarter way. We need to be thoughtful, intentional, purposeful, collaborative. We need to think hard about these questions of how we maintain resilience. Now you're all here today, and you've been invited here today, very, very particularly, and my colleagues have worked very hard to craft the best possible invitation list. Because every one of you is being recognized for doing your part to contribute to resilience, for your energy, for your innovation, keeping Calgary moving forward, for tirelessly working for our city, but also because you have a part to play on the journey going forward. And that's really what today is all about. It's called an agenda setting workshop, or if you prefer three letter abbreviations, an ASW for 100RC. See, I used to be a management consultant, and I lived my life in TLAs, that's three letter abbreviations. And I've worked hard to try and stop that, thanks to Councillor Farrell and her plain language quest. But there are a lot of TLAs that you're gonna be hearing today, I suspect. But really what the goal is to share our lens with each other, to build on each other's efforts, to prioritize our efforts, to figure out how best to manage critical stresses and shocks. So what does that mean, really? Well, let's think of a few examples here. As you know, in the resiliency framework, we talk about four things: leadership and strategy, health and well-being, infrastructure and environment, economy and society. I have a slightly different frame that I like to use. And I like to talk about resiliency through the lenses of the environment, the economy, society, social, financial, environmental resiliency. And those are all things that we need to continue to work on together. So for example, when we talk about the flood, obviously we're talking about a severe weather event, we're talking about an environmental shock, we're talking about ways in which we as human beings can manage that. There are kind of two ways to go forward. You make room for the river or you mitigate against floods. And you got to figure out the right balance between those things in terms of building up that resiliency up front. Of course, we have to be aware of and responsive to climate change and what that means to our community. We have to make sure that we're stewarding our air, our land, and particularly our water in a very responsible way. The biggest stress that we're facing right now, of course, is economic. We've gone from having the lowest unemployment rate in the country for many, many, many years to the highest in under 18 months. I like roller coasters. This is too much of a roller coaster. We've gone from having essentially 0% vacancy in our downtown core for many, many years to 30% in under 2 years. So clearly, we have to be able to build a system that is better able to manage these stresses and shocks moving forward. I particularly today, though, want to talk about social resiliency. And at the outset, I mentioned that we're living in scary times. And so the question then becomes, how do we respond? When we are in a place whose core strength has been about opportunity, when we're in a place whose core differentiating factor, whose core success factor has been that simple truth, that every single person in this place, in every corner of this city, regardless of what they look like or where they come from, regardless of how they worship or whom they love, where every single person in every corner of the city has the opportunity right here, right now, to live a great Canadian life. It's the promise of our community. It's what we work on every single day. How do we do that in the context of a world where that doesn't seem to be a universal truth? In a world where those angry voices are growing louder and louder and louder, where that sense that I'm looking after myself and no one else is the prevailing ethos. And I would argue that that is actually, today, our number one resiliency challenge, is figuring out how the prosperity of our community applies to every single one of us in our community. I've been spending a lot of time lately, for obvious reasons, with faith groups across the community. I've been spending lots of time in churches and cathedrals and temples and gurdwaras and occasionally even in mosques. And I've been thinking a lot about the common values that bind us together. And I've been thinking a lot about that famous Franciscan prayer. Lord, let me be an instrument of thy peace. And I think about how every one of us, everyday people with our everyday hands, our everyday hearts, and our everyday voices, has the opportunity to be an instrument of that peace. How every single one of us has a role to play in building that social resiliency. How do we do that? Many of you know that I have a particular dream for this year, Canada's 150th birthday, the sesquicentennial of Canada. I actually have two sesquicentennial dreams I'm working on. The first sesquicentennial dream is I'm trying to say the word sesquicentennial as much as possible, because it is super fun to say, and when do you ever have the opportunity to say it? A couple of you seem skeptical. On three, I want you to say it with me. One, two, three. Sesquicentennial. Didn't that just make your whole day? Et pour ceux qui parlent français, c'est toujours plus fun en français. Sesquicentenaire. I happen to think that sounds both delicious and dangerous all at the same time. My real sesquicentennial project is one that I hope that you will help me in and spread through all of your networks in this city and around the country. And it really is about that Franciscan prayer. Let me be an instrument of thy peace. It's to encourage every single Canadian to give an anniversary gift to the nation. And that anniversary gift is three acts of community service. We're calling it Three Things for Canada, Trois Gestes pour le Canada, and that's all it is. Encouraging every single person to use their hands, their hearts, their voices to do three acts of community service. Could be small, shovel your neighbor's walk. Could be big, join the steering committee for 100 resilient cities. Doesn't matter. The point is every single one of us making service a part of our lives every single day. And if we do it, if we succeed in spreading that virus of service around our country, that's 100 million acts of service this year. 100 million acts of service for your neighborhood, for your city, for your nation, for your world. And the world in these difficult and broken times will never again be the same as a result of Canada's 150th birthday. And I think that's a pretty good dream. And it's a dream that talks about who we are as human beings. Some of you were in the room yesterday when I mentioned that it's become fashionable to think of those of us who want to talk about love and compassion and kindness and mercy and humanity as being somehow fragile. They like to call us delicate snowflakes. Well, a number of my colleagues in the room here and I run the snow removal system here in Calgary. And I think it's safe to say that enough delicate snowflakes put together are the most powerful force in the world. And never, 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 never mistake that desire for compassion and kindness and mercy and love and humanity for weakness. It is not weakness. It is strength. It is strength beyond the imagining of the small-minded and the intolerant. And to me, that is the best possible definition of resilience. So, thank you all. Thank you for being here. I wish you great deliberations today. I'm going to be in and out myself, and I can't wait to see what we come up with. Thank you.